driving over here was pretty special. The colors are spectacular. Thank you all for coming. Today we're going to have some music provided by Linda Norby Simpson, formerly from Barron, now from Robert, Wisconsin, and myself and Steve Midville, formerly from Dallas, South Carolina. So hopefully we'll get to do this today. this is the first time we've ever done this, so.
We don't know quite where the outstanding
new
okay,
we're going to give it a shot. But thank you all for coming. Hope you enjoy the music. And we'll see you afterwards. I believe there's coffee afterwards, right?
No, before.
Everybody's revved up.
Okay.
Welcome everybody online. Appreciate that. So, we begin this morning with our confession. Blessed be God, the one who forms us, Jesus who bears the cross, the Spirit who makes our joy complete. Amen. Let us bow before God in humility, confessing our sins. Steadfast and faithful God, you have revealed the ways of justice, yet we fail to follow you. We are overwhelmed by the world's violence and suffering. We are afraid to risk what we have for the sake of others. For the harm we have caused, known and unknown, forgive us. For the unjust demands we place on others, Lord, your creation, forgive us. For the ways we turn away from the good and holy, forgive us. Lead us back to you and set us on the right path. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. God's justice stretches beyond all understanding. God's compassion is beyond compare. In Jesus, God is always making a new way for us. In Christ, you are already and always forgiven.
Amen.
But love grows old and waxes cold.
Please join me in the praying of the prayer of the day as you find in your bulletin. Sovereign God, raise your throne in our hearts. Created by you, let us live in your image. Created for you, let us act for your glory. Redeemed by you, let us give you what is yours. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
First reading is from Isaiah 45. Thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have grasped, to subdue nations before him and strip kings of their robes, to open doors before him, and gates shall not be closed. I will go before you and level the mountains. I will break in pieces the doors of bronze and cut through the bars of iron. I will give you the treasures of darkness and riches hidden in secret places, so that you may know that it is I, the Lord, the God of Israel, who call you by your name, for the sake of my servant Jacob and Israel, my chosen. I call you by your name. I surname you, though you do not know me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. Besides me, there is no God. I arm you, though you do not know me, so that you may know from the rising of the sun and from the west, and there is no one besides me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. I form light and create darkness. I make weal and create woe. I, the Lord, do all these things. The word of the Lord.
Amen.
Now we'll read the Psalm 96, 1 through 9, responsively. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth.
Sing to the Lord. Bless the name of the Lord. Proclaim God's salvation.
Declare God's glory among the nations and God's wonders among the peoples.
For great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, more to be feared than all gods.
As for all the gods of the nations, they are but idols, but you, O Lord, have made the heavens.
Majesty and magnificence are in your presence. Power and splendor are in your sanctuary.
Ascribe to the Lord, the families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord honor and power.
Ascribe to the Lord my honor and the holy name. Bring offerings and enter the courts of the Lord.
Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Tremble before the Lord, all the earth.
Tell the Lord among the tongues of nations. The Lord is King, the one who made the world so firm that it cannot be moved.
Let the heavens rejoice, and let the earth be glad. Let the sea thunder, and all that is in it. Let the field be joyful, and all that is therein.
Then shall all the trees of the earth shout for joy at your coming, O Lord, for you come to judge the earth.
You will judge the world with righteousness, and the peoples with your truth. The second reading is from 1 Thessalonians 1, 1 through 10. To the Church of the Thessalonians in God, the Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ, grace to you and peace. We always give thanks to God for all of you and mention you in our prayers, constantly remembering before our God and Father your work of faith and labor of love and steadfastness of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. For we know, brothers and sisters beloved by God, that he has chosen you, because our message of the gospel came to you not only in word, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit, and with full conviction, just as you know what kind of persons we proved to be among you for your sake. And you became imitators of us and of the Lord. For in spite of persecution, you received the word with joy, inspired by the Holy Spirit, so that you became an example of all believers in Macedonia and Achaia. For all the word of the Lord has sounded forth from you, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but in every place your faith in God has become known, so that we have no need to speak about it. For the people of those regions report about us what kind of welcome we had among you, and how you turned to God from idols to serve a living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he had raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the wrath that is coming. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
surrounds us. And evil comes. Well, the body grows weak. And the spirit grows numb. Well, he doesn't forget us. When these things beset us, he sent down his love.
Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you.
you, O Christ.
Please be seated.
Linda has already set the stage for the sermon today. I kind of like church. Maybe, you know, maybe you will after you hear this one. But have you ever had a sibling tell you, "It's okay. You know, you can tell me anything.
I won't tell Mom or Dad."
Or perhaps you were the youngest in the family. One day you noticed that your older siblings were all being really nice to you. Is it a trap?
Maybe, maybe not.
In today's gospel lesson, people are in fact setting a trap. They are trying to trap Jesus. They were disciples of the Pharisees and some Herodians. Now, notice that the Pharisees themselves did not come to lay this trap for Jesus. They sent, I guess you could call them, they were called disciples, or underlings, maybe junior associates is another word. But for sure, they were amateurs. And this is an odd alliance between the Pharisees and the Herodians. The Pharisees hated the Roman occupiers. And they did everything they could to avoid cooperating with them. Herodians, on the other hand, well, they were also Jews, but they worked with the Romans. They were sympathetic somewhat to the Romans because Rome had appointed Herod to rule over the Jewish nation. And these Jews liked Herod. Supported him. So the two groups are not natural allies. Typically, they would not work together. But for instance, in this particular case, they had someone in common that they really disliked. Perhaps disliked isn't quite a strong enough word. They hated Jesus. They wanted him to disappear. They wanted him dead. It's helpful to understand also the timing of when this gospel takes place. It's on Tuesday during what we would call Holy Week. A few days earlier, Jesus had entered Jerusalem triumphantly, hailed as the King of the Jews. Palm branches were laid out in front of him, and palm branches were waved by the masses, the crowds that came to support Jesus. But Jesus, after that, cleansed the temple, cleansing being that he chased out the money changers and the merchants who were charging outrageous prices to the pilgrims who were coming into Jerusalem to celebrate Passover. At this point, Jesus had been telling everyone, or his disciples at least, "Don't tell people that I am the Messiah." But this week, at this time, he doesn't do that. Jesus knows his death is near, and he boldly proclaims who he really is. Now we get to the heart of the gospel. Notice how the disciples of the Pharisees begin by trying to butter up Jesus, complimenting him. "We know that you are sincere, teach the way of God and in accordance with truth and with deference to no one. For you do not regard people with partiality." They're setting Jesus up for the gotcha question. So here's the question. "Tell us, what do you think? Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" If Jesus says yes, he may seem to be in collusion with Rome. The masses could turn against him and abandon him. If he says no, he's a rebel, suspect of being against Rome, and he could be arrested for sedition. No matter how Jesus answers that question,
He is sure to offend one or the other group. To side with the Herodians was to commit heresy in the eyes of the Pharisees, for to pay tribute to Caesar was, in effect, to bow down before other gods. But to side with the Pharisees was to commit treason in the eyes of Rome. For to refuse to pay tribute to Caesar was an act of rebellion. Jesus knows this is a trap set by the Pharisees, so he says, "Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites?" So, how does Jesus reply to the question? Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not? Jesus says, "Show me the coin." They brought him a denarius. Now, a denarius is pay for about a day's work. So it's no small amount. And Jesus asks, whose head is on the coin and whose title? Now, the image on the coin was that of Caesar and was considered by the Pharisees to be a graven image, which was forbidden by Jewish law. The inscription on the coin required the required tax reads, "Tiberius Caesar, August, son of the divine Augustus, high priest." By using the coin, they are using this forbidden image, and they are also using a coin that declares Caesar as God. It is interesting to note that the disciples of the Pharisees just so happened to have one of those coins in their pocket and produced it when they were asked to. The emperor's image and the inscription on the coin were reminders that the Roman Empire was present in every facet of the Jewish lives. The image and the title also identifies who controls the economy. The fact that they produced the coin so quickly also exposes to everyone that everyone is accountable to the Romans. And they've been participating in Caesar's economy, willingly or unwillingly. The tax in question is a poll tax. That is, it's per head. So poor people pay just as much as the rich people. And that was burdensome, obviously, particularly on the poor. None of that money, however, that was collected stayed in the Jewish nation. It was all sent directly to the emperor in Rome. The local people found no benefit in that tax. "They give, therefore, to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's," says Jesus. Yes and yes. Give yourself to God, because it is to him that we belong. Give God what belongs to God. That is, we give ourselves. Give to the emperor what he demands, the tax. And so Jesus resolves their dilemma. Give Caesar the piece of metal, for it bears his image. On the same basis, give God what bears his divine image, namely us. We are made in the image of God. Give your money to Caesar if you must, Jesus says, but give yourselves to God. But we need to be careful here that we simply don't try to divide our lives neatly into two parts. Our world isn't all that simple, is it? It's not just black or white. We cannot simply make a list with two columns, one for God and one for everything else. The world in which we live is complicated. Governance, taxes, politics, our jobs, sometimes even that seems to own us. We are called to live in the world, but not of the world. Over and over, Jesus has told us that his kingdom is not of this world.
He was born in a stable, died on the cross, was mocked with a crown of thorns and a sign that mocked him in his agony. Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. And yet, 2,000 years later, Jesus Christ is Lord. He was, is, and always will be God. He doesn't need a coin or a statue or a cathedral to make him God. Today's Old Testament lesson says, I am the Lord, and there are no others besides me. There is no God. The psalm also reiterates that great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, more to be feared than all gods. Jesus is Lord. Paul, writing in Romans chapter 13, helps clarify for us. Pay taxes to whom you owe taxes. Respect to whom you respect is due. Honor to whom you owe honor. Rulers, leaders, kings, and dictators come and go, but God is eternal. God's reign is forever. I think Jesus is saying here, put God first. Cultivate and nurture your relationships with God, and then your relationship with your spouse, your children, your friends, your business will all fall into their proper place. We live our daily lives in a place of tension between God and the worldly kingdom. Nobody says this is easy. All of us make mistakes along the way. Governments are necessary to protect us and provide us with an orderly way to live our lives. But Jesus is saying, don't mess around with the things that belong to God. As Christians, we are called to be in the world, but not of the world. Live with the empire, but live for God. My prayer today for you and for all of us is that God will help us to listen to the Holy Spirit, to give us the wisdom and courage to live for God as we live within the world. Amen.
I'd like to sing a song for you by one of my new favorite singer-songwriters. Her name is Carrie Newcomer. Some of you may have heard of her before. She's a Quaker and has worked closely with Parker Palmer in some of the songs that she has written. And this song is for all of you, but especially if you're feeling confused or hurting in any way, just listen carefully. This is for you today. Thank you.
trusting in the transformative power of God's loving Spirit, let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Faithful God, your Spirit animates the church throughout the world and binds believers near and far into the body of Christ. Equip us for the work of faith and enlarge our hearts for the labor of love. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Creating God, the sea roars, the earth rejoices, and the heavens are glad at the wonder of all you have made. Bless the work of ecologists and conservationists, and all those who safeguard the riches of creation. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Sovereign God, you rule with authority over all of the cosmos. As you once worked through the ruler Cyrus for the good of your people, accomplish your purposes through the work of elected leaders and public servants. Guide them with your wisdom and compassion. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Caring God, your arms enfold all who are lonely, oppressed, despairing, sick, and suffering. Pour out your abundant mercy on all whom this world has neglected, abandoned, and forgotten, that they may know your joy. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, all of our life belongs to you. When earthly idols threaten to lead your church astray, remind us that you alone are the source of our eternal hope. Direct the work of the church, treasurers, councils, and all who manage financial matters. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Everlasting God, the saints of every age have sung your praise and shared your word. We give you thanks for their witness and pray that we may join them as citizens of your unending kingdom. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, into your hands we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your unending love and amazing grace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
We receive the offering.
Thank you. so. Sometimes he thinks he's still in Rotterdam. He watches tugboats down canals, calls out to them what he thinks. He knows the captain. Till Margaret comes and takes him home again through unforgiving streets. Cat tripping, she holds his arm. Sometimes he thinks he's alone, calls out her name. Let us go to the banks of the ocean, where the walls rise above the side sea. Long ago, I used to be a young man. Windmills whirl the winter in. She winds his muffler tighter as they sit in the kitchen. Some tea with whiskey keeps away the dew. He sees her in the morning, calls her name out as she makes the bed. She sings a love song, a song that Margaret learned when it was very new. They sing together in the dark. The Dutchman falls asleep. Margaret blows the candle out. Let us go to the banks of the ocean, where the walls rise above the silent sea. Long ago, I used to be a young man. Now hear Margaret,
thank you.
little Bob Dylan tune. Sung by many of the people called Forever Young. May God bless and keep you always. May your wishes all come true. May you always do for others and let others do for you. May you build the ladder to the stars and climb on every rung, and may you stay.
Rose is too.